I am Michael Kourosh. I live in Santa Barbara, California, one of the most beautiful places on Earth. My design center is where people come to reimagine their homes and spaces. I work with the best designers, clients with broad tastes, and experts who navigate the fascinating world of design. I'm always excited to learn something new, and I never say no to a challenge. This is Design Santa Barbara. Welcome to Design Santa Barbara. I'm Michael Kourosh, and today we are in Pompeii, in the foothills of Mount Vesuvius. Let's explore why this city has transfixed visitors since its discovery in the 18th century. Pompeii was an ancient city located near Naples. Its history dates back to the 8th century BC. Early residents were under the Greek sphere of influence and prayed to the god Apollo. Greek and Phoenician sailors used Pompeii as a port and trading location. For the next 200 years, the city flourished and eventually came under the rule of Etruscans. During the Samnite Wars, Greek and Etruscan influence over Pompeii diminished, and with the end of the Punic Wars and subsequent slave revolts, Pompeii became part of the Roman Empire. This granted Roman citizenship to the people of Pompeii. Due to its proximity to the Arno River and the Appian Way, Pompeii became an important location for the transportation of goods and people. New buildings, such as the Forum Baths, Amphitheater and a smaller Odeon theater were constructed in 70 BC. During the reign of Augustus, Pompeii saw major population growth and the addition of several government buildings. The city received fresh water from a newly constructed aqueduct, one of Rome's greatest engineering feats. Between 62 and 79 AD, Pompeii began to experience considerable seismic activity. By 79 AD, Pompeii had a population of 20,000. On August 24, 79 AD, nearby Mount Vesuvius began to erupt. The initial eruption resulted in a pumice rain that lasted for 18 hours. In this time, most of the city's population was able to escape. After the rain, a superheated ash cloud enveloped the city, leveling buildings and instantly killing the remaining population. Remains excavated from Pompeii suggest the citizens who stayed behind were attempting to protect their precious belongings, including gold, silver, and jewelry. The most detailed account of the eruption comes from the noted Roman historian Pliny the Younger, who watched the eruption from across the Bay of Naples. His uncle, Pliny the Elder, admiral of the Roman fleet, sent ships across the bay to rescue survivors. Although successful in getting some people out, Pliny the Elder himself was killed by the ash cloud. Pliny the Younger's account of the eruption was so detailed and consequential to future volcanologists that today eruptions in the style of Vesuvius are known as Plinian eruptions. In the years after the eruption, the Emperor Titus visited the site and pledged money to relief efforts, but it was decided not to rebuild. There is considerable evidence of looting in the decades immediately after the city's destruction. Marble statues, which likely survived mostly unscathed, were plundered and sold. As the centuries passed, Pompeii was eventually forgotten to history. Additional eruptions in the 400s and 500s AD further buried the city. Aside from the minor discoveries during the Renaissance, Pompeii remained mostly buried until 1862, when Giuseppe Fiorelli began excavations. Fiorelli began finding pockets in the ash and discovered that they were the locations of victims who were buried in the ash but decomposed over the millennia. He devised a way of injecting plaster into the air pockets and created statuesque creations of the victims' bodies. Since 1863, approximately 1,900 victims have been located, backing up the historic record that most of the city's population escaped. Between the 1920s and 1950s, archaeologist Amadeo Maori led the last large-scale excavations. Here, he discovered frescoes in remarkably preserved condition, and the world was able to gain a deeper understanding of what life in 79 AD was like. After an earthquake in 1980, it was decided that major digging would stop and instead small groups would focus on specific areas within the city. As recent as 2020, targeted digs have uncovered a restaurant with frescoes depicting the menu choices and a well-preserved large four-wheel ceremonial chariot. Today, visitors can walk through the ruins of Pompeii and take in the history of this ancient city, as well as the awesome power of nature's fury. Pompeii is a must-see city for any world traveler. I hope you enjoyed this show and looking forward to seeing you next week on Designs Underwater. Stay safe till then and don't go close to any volcanic mountains. Ciao. This week on Michael's Minute, we're going to be talking about my favorite subject, rugs. Every designer will tell you to start from the rug up. It's the key. We have personally curated a rug collection of thousands, and with over 100 combined years of design experience, we can help you find the perfect rug for your space. And if you absolutely have to look online, go to santabarbaradc.com or rugsandmore.com. Find the perfect rug, then come in here and see it in person. I will gladly show it to you myself. And with all our rugs 50% off, our prices can't be beat. Come into 410 Oliver Street and let us help you find your rug. Welcome to Design Santa Barbara. I'm Michael Kourosh, and today we are in Santa Barbara Design Center preparing to head to nearby village of Montecito, where my dear friend Susan Shan has just finished redesigning a beautiful French villa that I have actually had the pleasure of providing furnishings for before. I can't wait to see how Susan has reinvented this beautiful home. Oh, what a wonderful place.
Look at this door.
Look at this door. You feel like you're in Normandy.
How heavy is that, huh?
It's beautiful. Very nice.
All right. This is our entryway, and it's just a lovely little foyer till we get into the main room. Big mirror here and a bench because the kids love to put their sneakers on before they go off to school, and they like to check out their, you know, make sure they're okay for the day.
Beautiful chandelier in there.
Yeah, this is from the East Coast. You'll see a few of these matching as we go. Well, slightly different because they were all handmade and designed. So they'll vary, but they're beautiful wrought iron to play off the door too.
Fantastic.
Let's go look at the living room.
Love to see the living room.
Okay, so this room is a ginormous room.
It's a big living room, and I have to tell you, I have been here before. We decorated this house years and years ago for a friend of mine, and this looks like a completely different place. You showed me a picture of it, I wouldn't have not recognized it.
I hope you like it.
I love it. It's just so beautiful.
Hope you like it better.
20 years forward. It looks amazingly beautiful.
Well, this was a fun room because the client wanted to have this feel like one shared room with both spaces talking to one another. And you can normally put a piano here, but no one plays the piano. So how do you make that work? And so I think this ended up, working beautifully by sharing some of the properties. Like this soire table is the same piece of wood from the same tree, but we cut it in half. And there's a funny story behind this one where the arm on this is exactly perfect for the client's coffee cup.
To lay on there and put his coffee in there.
So they can lie in there, read their paper, and put their coffee cup there.
I can imagine. This is especially God made it for him to hold his coffee.
Right, exactly.
That's it.
And then we carried the rest over there to that area to be able to sit around and play cards or just sit and talk. So in this particular room, there's fun things. We've tried to take the old-fashioned look. I mean, we are now in France. We're in the French Riviera, and what I love so much about this town, Santa Barbara and Montecito, is that you go to places and you see Spain and you see France, and this was only built in the 50s, but it looks like we're back to the 1800s. So a lot of the furniture that was brought in, the client brought from the East Coast, and you'll look at some of the before pictures and you'll see some of these large sofas with lots of cushions that came pretty high with bold colors, and we wanted to bring it way down and make it much more organic and feel like it was just this flowing room of comfort and pillows.
It feels like, you know, you just want to go vacation
here. You want to go hang out
here. Yes, the south of France, and you're vacationing here.
And then you want to come here and you want to sit on this little...
That's what we'll do.
You want to come here and hang out, so...
Tell us a little bit about this beautiful photography that we actually had in previous shows. We had a house that the gentleman collected the same.
You have. So this is Lisa Christine. She's an amazing photographer. She has an incredible organization she works with where she saves girls and women all over the world. They've been in slavery and programs like that, and she was endorsed by the Pope.
Oh, that's wonderful.
So that's pretty special. So this particular image was of an arch in Morocco, and the client and I thought that it would be interesting to somehow bring touches of that. So when he bought this piece, we had this frame, this sort of that wood Moroccan weaving. There's actually a suede frame around that. And then we added in pieces like this little piece here feels very Moroccan.
It does.
And some of the pillows from your shop and your fabrics that I selected bring in that feeling of those colors of Morocco. And then you bring in Africa, because you know I always love
there
to bring
you go.
In Africa. So this is a multicultured room, Kuba cloth pillows, and
then
it goes
you have the
on and on.
Yeah. And now I see one of the most important things in the room is that America Martin, and we had her on our show as well. It looks like you picked every color in that painting and put it in the whole room.
Michael, the funny part about this, maybe it's not funny, I just think it's luck on my part, is that I had ordered those chairs from Italy years ago, long time ago, for the fabrics that were in suede, and this piece of art didn't even belong yet, wasn't part of this room. And I think we just got very fortunate that when the client fell in love with this particular America Martin piece, who we adore, look how those colors work.
It looks like
work
you made it for
as
it,
if
honestly.
It
was the vibrations in the universe that put together that painting for you.
Yes,
that's
it. Sometimes I kind of get that. It's like a channel. and these chandeliers were nothing like the ones you saw in the before images.
No,
they were very small.
Not.
These are huge, but there's a formula to measuring chandeliers. You measure the size of the room, and then you measure the size of the chandelier that the room can accommodate. These chandeliers, when I first got them again out of the truck, I thought, these are a nightmare, I'm so afraid. And then we put them up and they're perfect in here.
So. I mean, they are very big, they look like UFOs, but you know, they actually fit nicely in this room because the scale of the room is so big.
Yeah, I think they're just
beautiful. Very nice.
So let's go outside and let's walk through these beautiful doors.
I love these doors, they're just unbelievably nice. And they're heavy, they're
these are
made.
All the gorgeous metal, real metal doors with all
made
the little
real.
Knots
yes,
from them.
Look at that. And then you look like an arch. Beautiful.
All new. If you remember the old drapery that was in here, it was very old-fashioned and silky with pom-poms at the bottom and very heavy, and it felt like it dragged the whole room down.
This is much airier and happier.
We've gone very light now. So let's walk outside.
Yeah, let's go check it out.
Come on out here, Michael. So all these doors open up to beautiful, beautiful little courtyards like this. Aren't we in France right now, or are
this
we
is
in
crazy.
Santa Barbara?
Well, I think we are lucky we are in Santa Barbara, to be honest with you. I think it's much nicer. But this is beautiful. Look at this thing, what you did.
We heated this out here. It's got a great, massive, beautiful fireplace.
And this beautiful chandelier,
You know this person, don't you?
I know the person who makes those. They look old, but they're brand new, made of different pieces, and they bury them in dirt to make them look old. But they're beautiful. They look really authentic and nice.
And then, of course, I love my lanterns.
Yeah, this is your legacy. It's gonna be forever. Look at this, beautiful.
At nighttime, it's gorgeous here because the light is on, the lanterns are glowing.
We should make a night show.
We should.
Seriously.
Okay, we can catch fireflies. So that's on the East Coast. But the gardens are everything here, so I have to show you these gardens. You need to see this garden now.
Oh, I do need to see this garden. This looks like paradise.
Well, I think it might be, right?
I think this is better looking than Promised Paradise, honestly. Look
at
this place.
You've got beautiful mountain views. You've got these gorgeous, everywhere you look, these little areas that you can go out into and breathe and look out at your view. You've got, you're surrounded by
little... And you don't see no neighbors?
No. You see lemon trees everywhere.
And then you have the water running in the background.
And look at these oaks.
They're dreamy.
And then, of course, down here, that you know...
Of course, every oak has
your bridge.
Light hanging, too.
Right.
Every one of them.
And then what about the bridge? This bridge goes across.
Oh, my gosh.
And you end up at a little area that's private, and it's a fire pit and chairs.
I'm going to go there later.
We're going to go there later. And then up here is the patio area where all of this has been refurnished. Beautiful teak wood, large umbrellas for shade. A built-in, we did a wonderful grill out here because they love to cook, a fire pit up here with gas lines, the swimming pool. You don't have to go anywhere but here.
You should tell Hollywood that they should not fly to France to make a movie. They should come here
right.
And pretend it's France.
Let's come here.
That's it.
Well, let me show you next the dining room and then we'll move on from there.
All right, it's getting better and better.
Let's go.
Let's go.
This is the dining room.
This is one of my favorite rooms in the whole house after the kitchen.
Yeah,
look
at the size of this table. They have a big family, they have big Thanksgivings. This room, if you look at the before shots again, you'll see that it was very old-fashioned looking. A lot of those very small little shaker chairs from Vermont, that type of thing. So we kept this wonderful table, this
is
beautiful.
A very nice table, yes.
And brought in some great woven chairs just to make this room feel a little more casual. And all the draperies just a little bit softer, not so formal as the ones with the big velvet, heavy drapery. Just nice gauze, sheer drapery. And you know I love my lighting. It makes a room.
These are very unique. I have never seen them anywhere else. And I think you're the only designer I deal with that has these type of lightings. They're very unique and nice. Beautiful.
I work hard on these. So I design these with the company on the East Coast. And it's LED lighting, so it only lights ever so slightly around the circumference of it.
Plenty of lights. You want to sit here and, you know, if you're a good cook, you want to have stadium lights, but
you've got all your sconces that give you the extra light.
Beautiful.
You're not going to cook in here. Well, this is a fun room now. And this is now a little less formal for Thanksgiving dinner for a family of 8 or 10 or 12.
Oh, yeah, you can extend this too, by the way. Yeah. There's plenty of
space.
And we pull
in some of their, that's the old chairs. We've mixed some of their old furniture. Again, I want to always say that when clients come, I think it's really important not to make this isn't my home, this is their home. So when they bring with them furniture that they've collected all their lives from their family, it's important to incorporate that. So this old break front is from, you know, way back to grandmother's days, and the same thing with those chairs. So they still live here, but in a much more contemporary context.
Beautiful. You were telling me about a powder room?
Oh yeah, I want to show you the powder room on the way to the kitchen.
There you go.
It's just fun. I mean, you know me in powder rooms.
You can make beautiful ones.
And here's the powder room, Michael. Old and new mixed together with wonderful stone and wood, vanity, and sconces made of iron and crystal. So what a fun place to eat. Serve food, cook, and have a place to hang and watch television.
Beautiful. It's fantastic. Again, this is one of the biggest kitchens there is. What is the size of this place? Like 20 by 30 or even bigger?
Well, you know what? Actually, I had to measure this. I don't remember now, but when you measure it, the island itself, that size, needed a substantial size chandelier.
That island looks like a tennis court.
And this area here, well, this was your wonderful
rug. Oh, I love
rug.
That rug. That looks like a Star Kazakh. It's fantastic. Thank you for buying it.
Thank you for giving letting us have that. It's
love
lovely.
That thing.
But this kitchen itself has been a labor of love. Again, the chandeliers are all new and very large scale because you need to have something this large for a kitchen of this magnitude.
Absolutely. Actually, this is ginormous. You were mentioning it comes with a crate the size of a car.
It did.
And it doesn't look that big hanging here.
And it took 6 guys to stand on this large island and maneuver this into the ceiling. But it's all LED, which is fabulous. So we're saving light and preserving energy. And so are these wonderful fixtures.
So we're going to save $50 a year and a $50,000 chandelier. That's nice.
And this kitchen, he wanted light. They wanted
fantastic
light in this
kitchen.
They're cooks.
Beautiful.
Yeah, it's fun.
Range, amazing, you know, sub-zero refrigerator.
Would you mind cooking in this kitchen?
I don't mind cooking anywhere, but here especially you can cook everything. So.
Well, what's great about this kitchen too is so all these wonderful metal doors again that you see throughout the house are opened up with these very light curtains to bring us to the outdoor area. So this becomes just like, you know, Santa Barbara is known for, indoor, outdoor living, and all the homes I love to do, I love to open them up to the outside so that every room opens to the outside. And this house does that. Upstairs, the living room that you saw with the doors that open up to the outside, this whole area here. So,
and hopefully we get a shot to look outside when you're cooking at what we are looking at.
Well, I want to take you outside because I created this wonderful barbecue grill. There was none there. We built that on, and actually this patio was very small for the size of this house and the size of this lawn. I mean, it's 2 acres of land. It's a 6,000 or 7,000 square foot home. But the patio was very, very small. We wanted to be able to sit outside and be able to have dinners and parties that extended. So let me take you outside so you could see how we extended the stone and made it all blend in to feel like it was always like that.
Love to see that.
Let's go see it. And Michael, as we're walking outside, take a look down this hallway and look at the before and after shots and look how your rugs have emphasized the gorgeousness of this foyer.
Oh yeah, that looks beautiful.
Well, now we're outside.
Now we are outside and in front of this beautiful pool. Let's check that out.
So this area, Michael, all of this space was not here.
This is where you expanded.
This expanded all through here. And we were able to put a very large teak, which I love, this teak and gray fabric table, which is very worthy of
forever.
All kinds of wear. And this enormous umbrella, which will keep them nice and cozy. And it actually closes and swirls and swivels and does magic, just like that ottoman inside.
Absolutely beautiful, yes.
We built this in here. And then built in the gas fire pit area here, so this could be.
Oh, it has a built-in.
Well, this is, you know, it's actually gas, so that, you know, this had to be created as we extended the stone here. So now they've got fire pit and fire all year round here in all the houses inside where all the fireplaces are, and also across that bridge in the little fire pit.
Oh,
area.
Oh, there's where you put that.
Yeah.
Where we're gonna go barbecue.
Yes.
So. All
See,
right.
So I like fire and water. Fire and water everywhere.
It looks beautiful here, and it looks seriously somewhere you wanna spend time. And if you have a family, you wanna come outside. We're, as you said, Santa Barbara. You're mostly outdoors.
Yes, and French Riviera in Montecito.
That's it. So. It is two-story building, and you were telling me the master bedroom, you changed as well.
Oh,
maybe we can see that.
I'd love to show you that. It's a big difference.
Beautiful. Love to see that.
Let's go back inside.
Sounds good to me.
So.
And this is the master. You have changed completely.
Welcome to the master.
Wow.
So this is a lovely room now. It's just open to glorious views, and everywhere you go, there's a patio off of every one of the doors. And I'm going to take you out afterwards to this little sitting area, which is just so romantic. But this room, starting with your rug, of course, needed to be warmed up and contemporized. We took in a lot of their old furniture from the East Coast, which is, again, larger. And I like to mix people's personal things, so that's why you're seeing that. And this bed.
That's actually one of your good things, I should say, right here, because a lot of designers are a little bit snobby on this. Nope, you cannot use that, and this, that, and you do, which is very nice. I've seen it personally that you do, which is very nice and makes people like their interiors even more than they would have not.
Thank you, Michael, because then it becomes more their home.
It's not a compliment, it's just you're so good at it.
Thank you. I appreciate that. So this piece up here is it's an international piece. These artists hand weave this, and this is called Lions of the Night. So it's a zodiac piece in a sense. If you look at the little numbers around that, and the client happens to be a Leo, so this was perfect. This took about 7 months to make, and it took even more time to actually hang it. I won't tell you a funny story. There was a disaster story. I never like to hang art behind a bed because, God forbid, we have an earthquake. We are in Southern California, and somebody's sleeping, and this piece of wood or stone or glass or metal from a frame falls on a person's
head. Yeah, but in this case, it's a woven carpet.
It
falls, it's going to be fine.
So, we had experts from the museum hang this and actually build a wooden bracket with the holders, and now this is in there very securely, so they never have to worry about anything falling on their
heads. Beautiful.
Yes.
All right, so you have a cover for the bed, which is very tribal looking, and it matches the Moroccan rug.
Well, the color just is to warm it up a little bit, because you know, they already came with this leather, low, very contemporary leather bed, and I was just trying to soften this up a little. It's not done yet. It still needs some big pillows and, You know me and pillows.
And yeah, those are very nice pillows, actually, but you probably have a few more layers.
We need more. I'll have to come shopping.
Yeah, that's
it. We're still finishing the final touches. It needs a few more pieces of artwork.
Did you bring that chandelier in?
I think that's from you. Is that from you?
It's from old times.
But look how nice I had these. I had the window coverings made to match this whole feeling and keep it light and romantic in here.
And the ceiling looks beautiful with the whole thing. It's fantastic. I mean, it's really relaxed, and if we don't talk, it gets very quiet.
Well, then you get the fireplace at night, so.
It's beautiful.
Well, you want to go sit outside and I'll show you how.
Let's do that. And actually, okay. Thank you for showing the whole house. It's just fantastic job you did again, as usual. You're a wonderful designer. And
thank you, Mike.
Thank you for showing us this beautiful property. Maybe we should go outside and have the 411 outside.
Let's do that, because it's, all right. Let me get my glasses first.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Well, once again, thank you for showing us this beautiful home.
Oh, and it's my pleasure.
I loved it. So my question is, how do you take a themed house? Like, this place looks like a southern French, let's say around Nice area home. Mm-hmm. And it has certain characters, certain things people expect to when you walk in. Last time I entered the house, when previous owners had it, it was expectation met completely. This is a southern French home, so provincial. So here we go. How do you take that house, bring it up to this beautiful, more modern, more transitional look that fits in today's interiors?
Okay, that's a good question.
It's a long one, but.
It's a long one. Well, mostly part of it is that I've traveled quite a bit. I've been to the south of France, Italy. This is where I do a lot of my buying. So when I walked into this home, I was familiar with what was expected. And when I saw that very large, puffy furniture, and I could live with it, but the client was not happy with it. And they had come from the East Coast, and they were younger and hipper, and they didn't want that. So part of it always comes from the client's request first, because it's really a collaboration. I spend most of my time before I go to work finding out who the client is, what are their passions, what do they do in each room, how do they want to live in each room, what are their favorite things to do, and what are their favorite pieces of furniture they brought with us that they can't live without. And there's some that they're willing to, let's just say, condo out, from Marie Kondo, who does the... So once we get to that point, I know what I need to work from, and then it's a labor of love. I love to design lighting, as you've seen what I do, so... And a house like this needed new lighting. It was dark everywhere, so that was a great part of my passion for this. And then a lot of the contemporary furniture, we traveled all over, and also to your shop, and found some great pieces that work, and the rugs have to be changed.
That's it, yes.
So it was a blast. I love this property. I love all my properties. I love all my clients. You know that.
You do, and they love you too.
They become friends.
So yes, that's basically answers my question.
Good.
And thank you again. I appreciate it very much.
Loved it, Michael.
Next week, we are another 411.